Hi everyone, and welcome to this tutorial bite for Oxygen Not Included, which is all about petroleum boilers. This is an advanced, and usually later game build, for boiling oil directly into petroleum using a heat source. I'm going to explain the full process, and why it's so good, then explain how to build and run them. So let's jump right into the process, which starts with three oil wells and oil reservoirs. I explained these in their own tutorial bite, and they will take 1 kg per second of water each to make a full pipe of 10 kg per second of oil. Now by using the petroleum boiler, this makes 10 kg per second of petroleum, converting all the mass. This is unlike the oil refinery building, which loses half, and it will shortly become clear why this makes such a big difference. The petroleum is then burned in 5 petroleum generators for 10 kilowatts of power, also making 3.75 kg per second of polluted water, and 2.5 kg per second of carbon dioxide. If this carbon dioxide is fed to slicksters, then it can sustain 75, which themselves make 1.25 kg per second of petroleum. Feeding this into another petroleum generator will support another 9 slicksters, taking the total to 84, or 10.5 full ranches. I will include these extra petroleum numbers in brackets. If the slicksters are kept groomed, then they will rapidly produce more slickster eggs, which can be turned into meat and then barbecue. 75 slicksters will produce around 10 eggs per cycle in practice for 32,000 kilocalories of meat or 40,000 kilocalories of barbecue, supporting 40 jupes. Now for the polluted water, we can convert this back into normal water, potentially through a water sieve, but preferably by boiling in a hot industrial brick. This can conveniently combine boiling the polluted water with the slickster ranches, and I explained these in a dedicated tutorial bite. This shows a key point in that the petroleum boiler produces more water than it takes in, making it infinitely sustainable and self-sufficient. Now let's compare this to an oil refinery, which loses half the mass of petroleum and halves the water output. This means it makes less water than it takes in, so a constant input of additional water is required, although this is possible. Going back to the boiler, let's not forget to add the power draw, and the design will run 2 liquid pumps and 3 oil wells constantly, a draw of 1.2 kilowatts, and this takes the net output to 8.8 kilowatts. Then the last thing to add is the natural gas output from the oil wells at 100 grams per second, which is enough for a little over one generator, and this means more polluted water and carbon dioxide. So as you can see, the benefits are large and many, plus it literally has no downsides, assuming it runs smoothly, which is easier said than done. But let's look at that now. The design I'm going to demonstrate is a counterflow of 10 kg per second. Whilst there are other ways of doing this, this method is extremely efficient and was popularised by Francis John. I need to give credit to him here, and much of this design is based on his. There are 2 main parts to cover, managing the heat source and the counterflow, which I'll look at first. A counterflow heat exchanger may sound intimidating, but all they really are is flowing 2 materials in opposite directions, or counter to each other, to maximise heat transfer. This holds a better temperature difference through its length. Here, the oil is piped into the heating area, gets boiled into petroleum, which then flows back down against the oil. You can do 1 or 2 tile high runs, but 2 allows for dupe access for fixing the boiler, and don't be surprised if these do break. Vacuum out the entire area beforehand to avoid unwanted heat transfer or flow issues, and a vacuum liquid lock is very helpful. Of course, atmosuits will be required for this due to the temperatures and vacuum. Here is how I build most of the design and then vacuum out. This design runs back and forth to make it more square, and the exact shape isn't important, but the length is. The point of this heat exchanger is to heat up the oil to near the boiling point, which is 403 degrees Celsius. Doing this means we only need to take a little bit of heat from our heat source, making it more efficient. Once preheated, the heat injector adds the last little bit of heat to make petroleum. A heat injector is a mechanised airlock between 2 surfaces. When shut, heat transfer is allowed, and when open, the vacuum prevents heat transfer. The design I'm showing here uses diamond window tiles, which are highly conductive. Diamond can be dug from the oil biomes as well. The mechanised airlock is best made from steel due to its high melting point and thermal conductivity. To control the door, a thermosensor is used, and this needs to be set to just above the boiling point of oil, so 405 degrees is perfect. Because we need to get the oil to just under 403 degrees, the heat exchanger length is key. If the exchanger is too long, the oil will boil in the pipes and break them. If it's too short, then more heat will be drained from the heat source. Unfortunately, there is no fixed length that will always work, because of variables like the pipe material, oil input temperature, and exact design. Instead, you have to build a design of roughly the right length, then tune it by swapping radiant pipes for insulated pipes. I have done some testing to give good starting recommendations, and this design as shown has two levels of 16 length. For copper or gold radiant pipes, this longer top layer has all 19 segments of radiant pipe. If using cobalt this is 15 long, before going to igneous rock insulated pipes, and for aluminium it's 13 radiant segments. To tune the length, check the output temperature just before the vent. If the pipes are breaking because it's too hot, replace radiant pipe segments until this stops. This is a good reason to make the top section 2 tiles high for dupe access. If notably under 385 degrees, then add in more radiant pipes. Anywhere above that is good, but the higher the better, as long as it's stable. The last point for the counterflow is to pump the petroleum out. This is simply done with a liquid pump attached to a hydro sensor to stop it running dry. I use above 100 kilograms for the setting. Remember that the pump needs to be steel to not overheat. With that explained, now let's look at heat sources. There are two primary ways to provide the heat, and these are magma or a thermo aquetuner. Starting with magma, this is most commonly found from volcanoes, which are a renewable source. It is possible to do this with a magma pool, such as at the bottom of the map, but this means constantly extending a heat spike, so I will focus on volcanoes here. I will cover heat spikes in the tutorial bite for geothermal power. To capture a volcano, enclose it with insulated tiles, ideally made from obsidian, and vacuum out the area with a liquid lock. Once vacuumed, remove the pump, wires and pipes, also clearing up all debris. I'm showing here quite a small magma tank, but in a real game you can make this bigger. Any volcano or minor volcano should work, as long as the oil comes out of the counterflow at over 375 degrees. The key to this room is to use a magma blade, which is a community name given to this design of 10 tiles that carefully controls magma flow. This is because magma is very viscous, so passing it through a one tile gap will make a blade exactly 10 tiles long. In this design, a mechanized airlock holds back the magma blade, and alternates with a second to control the flow. Both doors need to be steel, and be sure to make any automation wires in contact with the magma out of steel too. The magma comes into contact with the heat exchanger, and slowly solidifies as the heat is drained to boil the oil. Once it becomes too cold, it's drilled and dropped into the waste rock area. It's important to also vacuum this area to avoid heat transfer. But to ensure the drill can be cooled, a small amount of liquid is needed here. Put a tile in to catch extra liquid, then use a bottle emptier to splash a small amount of oil onto the tiles, and mop up the extra after. To cool the drill, I run the oil input through the metal tiles and make the drill from steel. The automation is a little complicated, and I would suggest simply copying the layout as a starting point. The thermosensor controls the process and remains red when the magma is hot. Once the magma has become too cold to boil the oil, the drill is turned on and the waste door opened. After the drill has had enough time to clear the igneous rock, the filter gate then allows the signal through, and I use 25 seconds. This toggles the doors at the top to drop the new magma down, and closes the waste door by resetting the memory toggle. Now a new batch of magma heats the boiler, and the system resets to prepare the next batch. An important consideration is the thermosensor setting, and how cool the magma can be while still boiling the oil. The lower this is, the more efficiently magma is used. But the temperature you can achieve depends on the exact design of the heat injector and the materials used. In testing, I managed to get this all the way down to 420 degrees, although this doesn't quite match my real game experiences. I would recommend watching this carefully, and set the sensor at the point where oil stops boiling immediately. Using thermium for the door and tiles may help to reduce this, due to its better conductivity. And that is everything for the volcano boiler design, so I'm showing here a one-take visual reference if you want to reproduce it. Moving on to the other heating method, we can use an aquatuner to generate the heat. The aquatuner needs to be made from niobium or thermium. As niobium is a space material, it's only available in the late game, and I will explain how to get these in another tutorial bite. Supercoolant, another space material made from fullerene, is ideal as the coolant to generate enough heat, or two aquatuners with a water coolant could also work. The setup here is essentially a cooling loop, but for heating purposes. This is why a thermosensor is used to turn on the aquatuner, and not a pipe thermosensor. The aquatuner runs to make a stable reservoir of heat to boil the oil with. I surround the aquatuner in petroleum and set the thermosensor to just below the petroleum boiling point, so 530 degrees Celsius. Now the last thing to do is to make sure the aquatuner can keep pulling heat from the coolant. If we didn't do this, then water coolant would freeze, or supercoolant would reach absolute zero, and after that, no more heat could be taken out. So we need to continuously add heat back to the coolant. Fortunately, we have a continuous heat source in the petroleum output. We can transfer the heat by simply running these through some metal tiles with both liquids in radiant pipes behind them. In testing, I found three tiles of length to be stable, but the sure way to check is to monitor the coolant temperature. As long as this is not decreasing to absolute zero, then the exact stable temperature doesn't matter. And that is all for this design, so here is the one-take reference for this as well. And so that's everything for this guide to petroleum boilers, in Oxygen Not Included. I hope this inspires you to give this a go, and thanks for watching.